I must say, this is my first time in Taiwan. Actually, my first time in Asia. I'm really excited. And thank you. I've only been here for 2 days, but 谢谢你们的邀请，我很荣幸来到这里。 Before I speak, I've got something important to say. This is TED, so they told me to be very brief and to the point, concise. So I promise I will be as brief as possible, no matter how long it takes. I come from a conference that was held in Doha, Qatar, at the International Educational Resource Network Summit, one of the most important conferences in the world about education. And I've done it a couple of other times. So, right, successful, running around the world, everything was laid out for me. Not. And I come from a small village in the north of Italy, from a lower middle class family, actually, to be perfectly honest, to European standards, a pretty poor family. And if I look back in my past, I realize that very few would have bet on me. I was, you know, one of the losers. I was kind of a nerd. I'm proud of it. It was fun. Still am. So, but I mean, the school environment was really tough. You had to fight your way out. When I say fight, I don't mean in the metaphorical terms. I mean literally, fight. And as you can tell, I mean, that's me right there, the tough-looking one. Yeah. I was clearly the strongest and biggest of the whole bunch. So, no problem for me there. When I was 14, I had to decide the high school to attend. And my teacher, he said to my mom, Miss, I'm sorry, but your son is not one of the smart kids. No, he's, you know, kind of stupid. So he was asking weird questions. And you should just send him to work. You know, don't bother sending him to school. And certainly don't send him to the gymnasium, the toughest school in the country. I mean, ever. And so my parents, being the obviously awesome parents that they are, they didn't listen to that pile of nonsense, and they sent me precisely to the school that they said I would never be able to make it. And 2 years later, I was given a chance. I won a full scholarship for a very prestigious school in the north of it, actually close to Slovenia. It's called the United World College, whose mission was to make education a force to unite people, nations, and cultures, for peace and a sustainable future. Just like my previous school, the same thing. Yeah, it was kind of like that. But this was my turning point. In that school, I had amazing teachers, and they were the best. Because more than just teachers, they were mentors. They were guides, and they were friends. They told us that we could be anything we wanted. We could do anything in our life if we believed that we could do it, if we had a plan, and if we acted on it, right? That making peace on Earth was not a hippie dream, but it could have been a reality. So that gave me the vision and the strength to take on many challenges that I've gone through all my life, and it brought me to where I am today. If I'd listened to my teachers back in my previous school, I'd probably sweep in the floors of the school by now. But how many kids didn't have this opportunity, right? It's nice to say the success story of one guy, but how many people were stuck in a small town with uninspired teachers, violent classmates, and no hope on the horizon? In the past couple of years, I traveled extensively in many countries, many continents, schools, universities, Fortune 500 companies, and I can tell you that my story, actually, it's not my story. It's maybe your story, or maybe it's your story. It's a story of thousands of people that I spoke to individually. Like, they come up to me and say, I had the same thing. Thank you. And these are just the ones that I spoke to in person. It's probably millions of people, or hundreds of millions, who knows? I mean, this is a tragedy, right? Why is this happening? And many people ask the question, are we preparing children for the uncertain future that lies ahead? But before we can answer this question, I think we must first address two very important issues. The first is, do we even know what we're looking for? I mean, what's the purpose? What is education for? Because if we don't agree what education is for, then we can never say we're doing a good or a poor job. So I'm going to tell you what education was for. And education was created for making factory workers. See, at the end of the 18th century, industrialists had a problem. They really had a hard time convincing people to leave the open fields and come and work at a factory with dark rooms, 10 to 12 hours a day, repeating the same monotonous, mindless task over and over, obeying every order without ever questioning anything, and never complain about it. I mean, you can see why they had troubles finding volunteers. I'm sure you've seen the historical reenactment by Mr. Chaplin. And so they created something called public education, a place where you are strictly separated by year, where you have to follow order, never question authority, and just do what you're told. Sit down and shut up until you're told otherwise. Just obey orders. We spend the first 3 years of our lives learning how to walk and talk, kind of useful skills, I'd say. And for the rest, we are told, sit down and shut up. Yeah, that sounds like a great idea. I'm going to do that. Just follow orders exactly as instructed. Never question authority. I remember in elementary school, one day the teacher told us, now, children, whatever I ask, I want you all to answer at once. Understood? OK. So how much is 6 times 4? And we all said, at once. See, for the purpose that we set out for 200 years ago, the education system is doing fine. In fact, it's working perfectly, creating obedient workers. The trouble is that this approach is no longer useful. It was never humane to begin with, but it was economically advantageous. And now it's neither. So are we preparing children for the uncertain future that lies ahead? The second problem is this. No matter what the supposed experts would like to tell you, and believe me, there are many of them, nobody really knows what the future is going to look like 5 years from now, let alone 10 or 20 years, which is when a child who's now in kindergarten will graduate and will have to find a job. What about the rest? What about the hundreds of millions of people who are working today and who could be out of a job because they are displaced by robotics and artificial intelligence 5, 10, or 20 years from now? I hear that some guy wrote a book about that, about robots stealing jobs, and you can read it for free and be a pirate. No, it's legal, it's Creative Commons, open knowledge. So we only know one thing for certain, that the only constant is change. After all, entropy isn't what it used to be. Change will always come, and most likely at an increasing pace. With this in mind, I think we must do three things. The first, we must prepare to accept change instead of fighting it. I've been afraid of change many times. I didn't want to change school, I didn't want to change job, and let me tell you, whenever I was afraid to do something, I didn't want to change, those were by far the most depressing moments of my life. All right? Being afraid is not nice, it's paralyzing. Because when you're afraid to fail. You're afraid, yes, I was afraid that, oh yeah, I will not make it to that school, I will not win the scholarship, but I will not be able to change up and find something else. You know, they were right, I was stupid, I couldn't learn, I couldn't do it. It's a downward spiral. But we live in a society that stigmatizes mistakes. We believe that failure is not an option and that we should play it safe. Study something that will get you a safe job, right? Work for a big company, look for stability. But you see, in a future of great uncertainty, stability is the illusion of the unimaginative. Lifelong, I think we must move away from the idea that teaching is for adults and learning is for kids. Learning is a lifelong experience, and anybody can be a mentor, a teacher, or a friend to someone else, or a guide. In our strictly individualistic society, our personal success is imperative. So we have standardized tests. We try to get the best grades at the best schools so we can get to the best universities, and then we can get the best job and outcompete everyone else and just be successful. But in collaborative society, your accomplishments, an accomplished individual is one who has contributed the most. both to their personal development as well as that of their fellow human beings. When I was at school, I remember that the way I learned best was not when the teacher was talking, was when one of my classmates would come up to me and say, hey, how, this is how you do it. Like in 5 minutes, we would solve something that in 2 hours of lesson, nobody understood. And I thought, why can't we just get to that? You know, those 5 minutes of peer learning. And when I was teaching it someone else, I was really testing my ability of understanding and reciprocating that. And also, it was much more fun and engaging. It was rewarding to be able to teach it to someone. Like, you can see it in their eyes, like, they've been going like this for 2 hours, and then you teach them in 2 minutes, and they're like, their eyes go like, yeah, I get it. It's fun, right? And we need time to experiment, to make mistakes, to teach ourselves, to teach others, maybe with interesting problems, not, yeah, here is the vacuum, imagine this idealized, no, real life problems. Problems that have many solutions, maybe no optimal solution, maybe no one knows what the answer is, maybe there are no answers, who knows? I mean, fun and challenging problems and the process of discovery, just like they were saying, starve them, not stuff them, right? The speaker before me, it's exactly right. Discovery. Learning is a process that happens when you're interested and engaged, not when you're receiving. This way, you foster the innate curiosity that is inside all of us. And finally, I think we must develop a strong culture of grit. Grit means passion, it means perseverance, it means never giving up, right? Determination. So many people see my success story, and they wonder what's different about me. Am I special? No. Do I come from a rich family? No. Am I some sort of genius? Nonsense. My teacher said I was too stupid to learn. So what's different? It's very simple. I had somebody who believed in me. And I never gave up. That's it. Studies have shown that intelligence, talent, and social status have very little correlation with your long-term success in life. So if you can find a person, if you can find somebody who believes in you, somebody who can look at you in the eye and tell you, no, you're not stupid, you're not crazy, go for it. That changes everything, everything. My drive has always been to fix stuff. Whenever I saw something, I wanted to either fix it or make it better or finding a more optimal solution. It was like whenever I saw like a toy or a desk or a bicycle or the school or politics in Italy, I wanted to fix everything. Didn't matter what, it was just, couldn't help it. And when I was 12, I saw this thing, this computer, which I could program myself, and it would do stuff for me. And I was like, holy cow, this is amazing! Like, seriously, I didn't have any money, I didn't have any resources, I didn't have any budget, but suddenly I could solve humongous problems that used to require thousands of people just by myself. The only thing I needed was determination, passion, interest, and patience, lots of patience. But then, when I found a community of activists, of hackers, of makers, people who challenge me, people who inspire me, everything got so much better, so much faster, so much quicker, and so much more interesting and engaging. It increased my reach orders of magnitude. And we need to foster our creativity, and I think that has a lot to do with mentorship, with guidance. First, I had my parents who believed in me. And then my school, the college, and then countless other people to which I owe everything, everything that I am now. There are many people here on the stage. You can't see them. Well, I'm not crazy, I don't really see them, but you know what I mean. I'm standing on their shoulders. If it hadn't been for them, I would not be here now, talking to you. And technology is now making this process easier, more scalable than ever. Because right now, your mentor doesn't have to be in the same village, doesn't have to be in the same town or even the same country, doesn't even have to speak the same language. We kind of forget that only 6% of the world speaks English natively and 73% of the world doesn't understand any English. But now technology is taking down also this barrier. For the first time in human history, we have the technological tools to bring about a revolution in education. But it won't come by itself. We need people too. And also, we need the right mindset. So that's my project, Esplori. Imagine if the sum of human knowledge were available to everyone on Earth, anywhere on Earth, to everyone in any language, on video. And imagine you could be a farmer in India, or a hacker in Taiwan, or a solar engineer in Ecuador. Imagine if you could teach your skills to anybody, regardless of where they are, or what language they speak, or how rich they are. Wouldn't it be great? But better yet, what if you could be a guide? What if you could be a mentor to someone who hasn't figured out yet what they want to do? Whenever I travel, I see thousands and thousands of young people, kids who tell me, I don't know what to do, but I need to decide my university, and my parents are telling me this, and my job, blah, 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 blah. They don't have the time to think, to experiment. They don't have any guidance. What if we could use technology to make that happen easily? Imagine a strong community of dedicated individuals who want to help each other, who are solving challenging and fun problems. Everything that I've talked about up until now in these 13 minutes, everything that I've learned in my life, everything that I am, it's right here in this project. So this is it. It's my mission, it's my passion, it's my drive. It's what keeps me awake at night at 3 a.m. and happy to do it. And with your help, I think we can make it. So that's my part. Now, since this is a conference about education, here's your homework. If you can inspire somebody to follow their passion, if you can give them a chance and make them feel special, I can tell you, in fact, I can guarantee you from personal experience, you will have saved a life. So, off you go. Save a life.